Welcome everyone, and thank you for joining on a Saturday afternoon, and also in the middle of the crisis that the country is going through. So this MSc Digital Society program we've started about 5 years ago as an interdisciplinary program at the intersection of information technology and social sciences. And we have, from the very beginning, we have been welcoming students from all kind of disciplinary and professional background. Of course, IIITB being a well-known institute for IT and a technical institute, we do get a very large volume of applications from engineers. So this is also, but they are also then supposed to train themselves in social sciences when they come from an engineering background. So that might sometimes lead to some kind of confusions and mismatch of expectations and so forth. So that's why we thought earlier we conducted a session where we got all our faculty members to come and talk to you and address some of the questions about the course, about the prospect of the course and what kind of things that we teach. So then we also thought, given that there are It's a new course, there is no other universities which are offering a similar course in India. There are a few others we found in Europe. So we thought that it might be a good idea to listen to our alumni now that we have quite a handful of them in the last 5 years, and they're doing pretty well for themselves in their career. So what we tried to do in today's webinar, that we tried to get our alumni who are working in different kind of positions. And so that you get a flavor of different kind of things or possibilities that this course offers you. And unfortunately, when we announced 4 of our alumni, Priyanka Arora, Harishikesh, and Pradyumna Taduri, and Abhijit Bharadwaj. Unfortunately, Abhijit would not be able to join us because, like many of us, he's also struggling with the pandemic, he and his family. So he could not join us, but hopefully in some other form, we will be able to connect him to some of the applicants. So with that, we also have with us today 2 of my colleagues and faculty member who teaches in this program, Professor Amit Prakash and Professor Janaki Srinivasan. So if you have any questions regarding the program itself and the teaching and the pedagogy, they would also be happy to answer some of your questions. So I just have one request to those client that please use your first name as your username so that we understand who are we speaking to. If possible, when you're speaking, switch on your video so that we can see whom are we talking to. And also, if that is, it's okay, it's not mandatory, but it would be good to have your video on while speaking. And introduce yourself, that who you are, what you're doing, and then before asking your question. With that, I'll welcome Priyanka, Pradyumna, and Harishikesh. Thank you for agreeing to join and talk to our prospective applicants and do this for us. So we really appreciate. So what I'd ask you, 3 of you, to then briefly introduce yourself, what you're doing now, how you joined, like how was your experience in the program, and how the journey from once you finish your program and where you are right now. If you can just, each one of you can speak for 5 minutes, 5 to 7 minutes, and then we can open the floor for more question and answer. Does that sound good? So I'll start with you, Priyanka.
Hi everyone. So I am currently working as a product manager with PayU. I recently joined PayU, say a month or a month and a half back. So I'll start from my initial step of entering IIIT Bangalore's Digital Society course. I mean, even like I was preparing for GATE, and then I eventually came across this course, and I realized that this is a very interesting way to look at things, especially when you get a social perspective towards the tech part of it, and you also get a to an extent get a managerial aspect to it as well. So post, I think 2 years gave me good amount of exposure with the flexibility to indulge into the type of courses and in type of projects that I really wanted to get into, knowing that I wanted to get into the product management domain. I mean, obviously it took time for me while I was in the course to understand what domain I really would like to get into. But then eventually, say by the second semester or so, second or towards the third semester, I was clear that we wanted to get into the product. I wanted to get into the product management domain. So from there, I think it started with the internship that I did with Covium as an associate product manager. And that eventually got converted into a full-time job opportunity. There is a lot that I learned in the course, which I got an opportunity to eventually use in while I was working as an associate product manager. We had a lot of UX research-based courses, project management-based courses. So all of that eventually added up into the first role that I played in my internship, which eventually got converted into a full-time associate product manager role. I think working there and also learning a lot about the industry for an year and a half, I moved on to Practo as a product manager. And I think all this while, right, Digital Society has given a lot of dips into data, to an extent into data analytics also, which also eventually feeds into product management, UX, which feeds into product management, and then project management, which also to an extent, if you're working in a startup, does feed into product management. So, and to a bit of technical knowledge also, I won't say too much of technical knowledge, but a bit of technical knowledge that again adds on to the end role, end goal here. So overall, whatever I learned through the course, a lot of it I could utilize in the product management domain that I'm into. Being the alumnus of the founding batch, I can say that definitely as you enter the course, you will see a lot of things happening, and you have to be very clear in your mind with the help of the faculty towards what you want to choose or what you want to go forward with. Because even in our batch, there were people who entered into various domains, like people got into data analytics, people got into research, people got into digital marketing, and then two or three of us got into product management, and we see ourselves to be doing pretty decent right now, and learning a lot from the course, and then obviously experience also counts in. So I think it's been almost four and a half years, and I feel pretty good as a product manager, and I don't feel that I'm missing out anything which other people in the same domain are not aware or are not like have not learned through. So yes, I just recently switched into a product manager role with PayU, and I'm working on the Lazy Pay product there, designing, defining a lot of things. That's about it. And just one more thing to mention, I did my Digital Society post my electronics engineering, and it is not a big shock as such. You can say that you were an engineering student and then you moved into Digital Society. It was a pretty comfortable move, and it was something which I am happy I selected.
Thank you so much, Priyanka. So Harishikesh, can we move over to you?
Yes ma'am. So good afternoon, everyone. Trust everyone is doing safe, everyone is healthy. And like when I started off my Digital Society journey, so I did my bachelor's in computer applications prior from Punjab University. And I was interested into the computer science aspect of it, but was not looking into a more of a pure tech kind of a thing. So Digital Society appealed me, basically. It was like, okay, this is something of different plethora of options that this course offers. And I joined a Digital Society in the second batch in 2016. Post that, I've been working with eGovernance Foundation from where I got placed from the college. And it has been 3 years now, and I didn't go with the plan. I'll be very honest here. I was open to all the opportunities that were presented to me. And the course actually provides you like distinct variety of domains actually to look into. And I I took each and every bit of it, and when I went to the organization, to a professional environment, I tried to use each and every bit of it. So a bit about my role currently. So I've been I started out in different teams within the organization, and there the organization was looking to how to scale the current technological platform across various governments in the country. So the learnings from Digital Society were really helpful, and we went on like scaling the product from one state to almost like 10 states at this stage. And Digital Society actually provides you that perspective, that lens. Okay, how do you deal with people? That was my biggest take of it, and how the problems are not only centric towards technology. And currently I've transitioned into a product role. I was into a program management aspect from working in almost for like 2.5 years before. And from there now we are looking into some of the most persistent problems that society is currently facing. We are working towards developing a COVID-based for a dashboard, basically, where we can track how many vaccines have been rolled out across the country, what are the endpoints of the vaccine. And we have been working towards in the civic tech space for a very long time. So it was all possible because of, I think Digital Society provided me that opportunity to like look into and to work towards one of the most invisible and the wicked problems that we have in our society. And I'll just give a brief about my journey. So I started out with my internship. So I was working as a UX research intern within the same organization, where we researched around how technological products are perceived across governments in the country. From there, I got an opportunity because of my distinct domain, because of this courses that I had taken in. I was sent across to various states across the country, and I worked extensively on the ground for almost like 2 years. And once we had that knowledge, and now I've recently transitioned into a product role where I'm working as an associate product manager. And we are looking into how we can make the product more user-centric. Some anecdotes that I like to present, and we recently formulated our privacy policy in the products. And one of the basis of that, the inspiration was that from Digital Society itself. So once you are out in the market, out working with various folks across who have done different bunch of things, Digital Society actually makes you a standout individual. And for me, it has been true, like the contributions that we have made across that has also helped the organization in getting decent size of fundings. It has also helped organizations to understand what a user-centric design is. So definitely, if you like grasp the knowledge that the course provides, it is one of a kind course that you can get. So any specific questions, if they are there, I'll be happy to answer. But overall, my journey was like very exciting, and I was fortunate that I made the right choice.
Thank you, Arishikesh. Thank you for that nice intro. So we'll switch over now to Pradyumna.
Hi. Thanks, Dr. Budisha, for inviting me and setting this up. It's really nice to connect with you after the winter school last year. I'm really also happy to connect with Harishikesh and Priyanka, who I not had the opportunity to connect with for quite a long time. And also shout out to Dr. Amit and Ms. Swati from IIITB. It's really great to connect with you. Hi everyone. Happy Labor Day to all of you. So my name is Pradyumna, and Harishikesh and Priyanka are my seniors. And so I started my Digital Society program in 2017, and I graduated in 2019. And I totally agree with the way Priyanka and Harishikesh have said it. You know, that this course is really an intersection of of many kinds of opportunities. And the idea, I guess, is that you spend the first year there trying to, you know, figure out, you know, what you like and what, you know, just explore really, and, you know, try to find out what is it that you want to do. And you have the space to do that. And you know, then I guess in the next year, you try and double down and sort of work on what you're interested in. And for me, you know, as an engineer, computer science engineer who sort of worked as a web developer for several years, this course to me was, you know, it opened things up for me as well. And so what I was interested in is, you know, research, and that's kind of the track that I took. And so, you know, the methods courses that this program offers are really important to get a sense of that. And yeah, so I also did my thesis to sort of double down on research. And yeah, and so now I work with Fairwork, which is a project that's based out of IIITB. I work with faculty here, and Dr. Janaki is on the call, and I also work with Dr. Balaji, who is also faculty. And yeah, so the work I've been doing for a year and a half is completely, you know, tied to digital society in the sense that a lot of my learning, especially from the research perspective, is something that I put into practice every day. So basically my role is to, you know, work with colleagues to design the research and then implement it. So work on multiple fronts along those lines. And yeah, I think that's really the introduction I have. Yeah.
Thank you, Pradyumna. So are there questions? Maybe now we can, or before we take questions, maybe Amit and Janaki, you can also introduce yourself quickly.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for showing up on a holiday afternoon, both to our alumnus as well as the prospectives. Really nice to meet all of you and hope everyone's safe. I teach here at IIIT Bangalore. I teach methods courses and also on privacy and on development. And I think have had the privilege of teaching all the alumni who are here on the call. Yeah, feel free to ask questions. I work with Pradyumna on the Fair Work project. So if you had questions around that, we could talk about that. I'm broadly interested in how different digital technologies are taken up by different sections within society. So how do things like gender or class or caste make a difference to how different people are able to use technologies? So what does inequality really mean in the digital age? So broadly, that's how I would frame the kind of things I do. I'm going to sort of step back and be in the background, but happy to, you know, take up questions if anyone had any about either the specific courses or the overall curriculum of the program.
Thank you, Janji. Hi, Amit.
Hi, I am Amit Prakash. I'm also a faculty member at IIIT, and I also offer a few courses to students of our digital society program. It's good to see Priyanka, Rishikesh, Pradyumna. I've been in touch more or less, but Priyanka after four or five years. I think it's good to see how all of you are doing, and this is all heartening, because what we want to do through this program is to fill the gap that currently exists in the industry, where you can go and work on products, you can go and contribute to a better kind of digital technology use across sectors by having a broader understanding of how technology and society interact. So this is an interaction with the alumni, so I'll also step back. And I am here if you have any questions or any clarifications on the program.
Thank you, Amit. So, yeah, so now the floor is open. Anybody has any questions? And all three of us, we take a back seat. Now the floor is open for Harishkesh, Priyanka, and Pradyumna. Please, it's your day.
So hello everyone, I'm Karthik Joshi from VIT Chennai, and thank you first of all for organizing this. This is very informative, each and all of the open visit sessions. And so I'm currently doing engineering in electronics and computer engineering, and I'm interested in two user research perspective, SCI research. So I wanted to know about the courses and the electives that helped gain practical exposure for getting when you say you worked at eWorks or Fairwork Foundation, how that helped you for I mean the courses helped you prepared you for the role that you are doing currently.
So thanks for the question, Karthik. So I'll say that yes, since you are interested in user research, I'll give you my journey, how it actually helped me out. So there are, if I talk about a couple of courses, the first one being the first stage of qualitative research that we studied in our first semester. And then the second one being the advanced ethnography. And both of these courses actually helped me out when I started out my career, I went straight to the field. And there I had to interact from top of the pyramid to the bottom of the pyramid. Basically, it can be from a bureaucrat to a minister. It can be someone who's delivering your bills. So your water or a sewerage bill or an electricity bill. So that understanding of how you actually conduct, you go with a research set of mind. So these courses actually help you to courses had like hands-on practical exercises where we conducted our own field studies for 6 months. And that actually helped me out in my profession. And there it also helped you to set a narrative, because imagine when you're talking to these folks, people are hesitant to talk to all of a sudden on an outsider. So these courses also help you to gel in. So it taught me a lot. I'll say it gave me a 360 degree perspective on what I want to achieve, what is the goal that I'm looking for, and how should I go about it. So that is where it helped me out. And still when I'm going, I've transitioned into a product role, still it is kind of helping me out there itself, where we are looking into who's our end user, because the kind of problems that we are dealing with, they're one of the most complex problems in the society. So there we had to take a lot of hypotheses. We had to take a lot of stuff where we had to go by assumptions. And the one core thing that you can look into is how you built around your user research. So there it helped us. It is currently helping me out. Yeah.
Hi, Karthik. Yeah, I think absolutely agree with Harishikesh on the the utility of the practical aspects of each course. So, pretty much in most courses, there is a practical component of doing research and figuring things out, and I think that was immensely valuable to working with others in a creative environment is really important to find out what are the things that you like, your strengths, and working and delivering and presenting a pitch is challenging, and I think you learn a lot from it. And I think as far as the subjects are concerned, one thing about this about the digital society program is that it is evolving over time. And so when I was a student there was a HCI course particularly on offer. I'm not 100% if it's on offer right now, but that course was, I think, pretty much bang on for you to understand user research, especially from a development perspective, and maybe not particularly from a product perspective, but I think working with so it is on offer, as Dr. Bidisha has pointed out. So I think working from that perspective, and if you're already set on user research, doing a thesis with faculty at IIITB would really cement, I think, your understanding of that. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, that I was coming to my next question, which was revolving around the thesis. So for this particular program, I think there are two options, like internships and thesis. So all three of you, like, can you weigh down, like, because there'll be great projects even in the thesis as well as internships. So what should be preferred for a user research role? Somebody could throw like that.
I think for user research, I'm not entirely sure here. I think I would leave this to the others. But I would say, I think it depends on user research as a topic, but I think it also depends on where it's being applied. So if it's something like in the context of the development sector, I think there's a lot more merit to doing a thesis. But I think this is definitely a question for the others.
Okay, I think Pradyuman put it up in the right way. It really depends on what you are looking forward to do or what you want to do next. So if it is that you want to enter or you want to pick up a project which is in the IT related sector or something which is with respect to an existing ongoing startup based project, then it would make all the more sense for you to work as an intern. And this will actually, you know, you get a lot of context on how the industry functions if you work as an intern compared to when you are doing a thesis, where you will get a good amount of dip into how to look at it only from a very, educational thesis perspective. Definitely, even that will add on to the industry experience if you want to work in an industry experience later. But to my understanding, and maybe Harishikesh can fill in better, the thesis would primarily help you if you are willing to get into a research-based role going forward. But if you are willing to get into the industry, I would want you to get your hands dirty by working with one of them.
Absolutely, I agree with Priyanka on this. So it all depends, it all boils down what you want to achieve. Okay, say for example, if you want to stay in academia, okay, for me, since I had never worked before, so I wanted the perspective, okay, whatever learnings I had gained from this course, can I apply them outside this course? That was one of my main motivations to step outside and when I went for an internship. Primarily, I was also inclined towards the research, but I was not sure, I was confused at that point. But this was one of my point is that, okay, yes, definitely I want to test the knowledge, the learnings from this course, and I want to apply it practically. So it all depends on where do you want to go. And I think one of the learnings that I had is that you should start exploring as soon as like you are done with your first year, because that will give you a lot of, I know you might not have a lot of answers at that stage, but still it will help you out that, okay, this is what I want to do, then you can evaluate and validate that as you move forward.
I think Priyanka also summed it up very correctly. Like, it depends on where I want to land up, so in academia versus thank you so much.
Hi guys, I know I promised to be in the background, but if I could just jump in for 1 second. I think it also depends a little bit on how you define research, right? So research can obviously be done within the context of academia, it can be done within industry, right? If by research we understand, especially in the context of user research, if basically what we are talking about is how do you go about understanding how the potential end user of a technology, what are the conditions of their life within which they use that technology, right? It's sort of applicable across demographics, I think. To Pradyumna's point, for example, his thesis was around platform work and food delivery riders, right? And Pradyumna, I don't want to speak on your behalf, but just to make the larger point that today he is doing research which is very, how should we put it? Harishikesh, you talked about, you know, trying it on the ground and so on, right? So the work that he's doing and I'm doing with him on the Fair Work Foundation is essentially around scoring different platform companies like your Ola, Uber, and so on and so forth to say how fair are they to their workers, right? And this is definitely a translation from like an abstract sort of conceptual underpinning of research to a very pragmatic way of taking it forward. So there is that. In fact, I would even say the kind of work that Harishikesh is doing, for example, right, is also research of a particular kind. So I think it depends a little bit on what you want to learn from your thesis. And I think another of our alumni at some point was supposed to interact with you, works with Google Photos. She did a thesis on how the public distribution system works in the context of sort of semi-urban and peri-urban Bangalore. And essentially, she was trying to understand how is it that people use their Aadhaar card or other documents to get their ration, right? And this is obviously a very different domain, public distribution, than say Google Photos. But the essential skills that she learned about how do you talk to people, how do you draw conclusions from what you see on the ground, sort of helped her through when she was doing other work on user research as well. So I just wanted to jump in with that. Thanks.
One another question that I had was, like, I have observed this, that in major part of user research also involves learning about the social construct, like there is intersectionality, technological, all the other aspects like marginalization, and I've been reading quite a bit about it, and feminist techno science and all of such aspects. So does this course prepare for that as well? Like, I think that would be important for a person looking for PhD in future, I guess.
Let the alumni speak. We can always speak. Let the alumni, I would like to see how they respond to this question.
It does, if I say so in a simple word, it, like in one word, it definitely does. Because you look into, when you're looking into technology, right, there is a notion that technology will solve everything. That's not true. You have to look at different aspects, you have to look at different parameters. And like you said, so when one of the challenges that we faced as an organization at a very, very earlier stages were that, who are we building it for? We really didn't know who the user was. And in terms of who the end user, basically, if I say so, there are different kinds of stakeholders within the system, who the end user was. And one of the things that we looked into were all these mappings. Like you said, we mapped each and every of these challenges to our user. And then we went to design the technology, basically looked into the problem, exploring the problem statement and the solution part of it. So definitely, I'll say the course actually has all of this. So when you are exposed to that situation, for me, it worked perfectly, it fitted in, and I was able to think in different constructs. So when you are in a room with different set of people, okay, there'll be a business folk into that room, there'll be a technologist in that room, and then there'll be you. So when I was there, I was able to bring in these perspectives onto that table. And then it's summed up as an organizational initiative. So yes, and I'll say it, the course, like I told, both of these courses, primarily it helped me in shaping up my career. So others, I'll be very interested what Priyanka and Pradyumna have been experiencing. So because mine was more of a philanthropic organization, but how it goes into like a total enterprise. So Priyanka, if you can like highlight that.
Sure, Hrishikesh. So I think user research is the base of product management, to my understanding. And that is what even a career jump, which Hrishikesh has taken. And you know, it is, you don't define a product until unless you know a user. How will you make a simple product like a credit card until unless you know the user you want to give a credit card to? So the user journey and the user, knowing the user, understanding the user, doing user research is, even at this level, like 4 years into product management, I don't remember a month when I've not interacted with a user, or I have not done some level of user study or user research. Because it is actually the user you are trying to cater to, and learning the skill to, you know, ask the right set of questions from these users, not with a bias. I mean, like removing the biases and then trying to ask the right set of questions and then trying to evaluate in a way that it actually adds up to your product or as an end goal is something which is very important. You know, and then user research definitely, I would say, is the core or the base of product management, to my understanding.
So I would say, you know, I think from a very practical standpoint, you know, at least for me in my, you know, educational sort of experience, you know, as an engineer in college, you know, I think my class had like 120 people or something like this in one teacher, right? What I really liked about this course was that sometimes the teachers can outnumber the students, right? And, you know, so my class had 10 students. And so what that really meant was you could really, you know, go after the faculty, so to say, and sort of really pursue what you want to do. And so you could do this through a reading elective. And there are so many experts in the subjects that you were just mentioning, Karthik. So you could pursue a reading elective or a project elective with this faculty and definitely hone your skills like that. So it's I think the sort of access to faculty like that is just, that was really one of the standpoints of this course, I think, yeah.
Janaki also teaches a course on technology in development. So the intersectionality part, I think that would also, you know, she does address in her course. So I thought she might also want to say.
Yeah, I just wish I hadn't made that statement about staying in the background, because this really puts me across as this really inconsistent person who said she would step back and keep stepping forward.
No, I am asking you to step forward.
Yeah, thanks everyone for your inputs. Yeah, we have at least a couple of courses, and I think like Pradyumna said, you can you know, choose to dig deeper through electives or reading courses, etc. So I teach a course on technology and development, which essentially looks at the history of how we think about development itself. And through the course of that, of course, lots of questions around caste, class, gender, participative development, all of that comes in. And I think also in Didisha's course on technology and society, you look at a lot of different social science framings through which you can understand how technology is appropriated by users, et cetera. And in all of this, things like feminist technoscience or participatory development and participatory design, all those questions come in. And I think there's a flavor of critical design and critical design thinking in all of this, if that's the kind of space you were referring to.
The key takeaway I got is that this course is specifically like for technologists who want to bridge the gap between like the social constructs. And so this will kind of bridge the gap between that. And that is the most important part, I believe. So yeah, thank you.
I'm Akansha. I'm currently in my final year, Bachelor's of Computer Application. I'm actually interested in this course. Actually, this course excites me because it has technology and social background. So like after studying BCA, I was not a person who really wanted to go into core computer science, because I understood that it's not my thing. So like this course really looked very interesting. So interesting to me. So I like, so that's why I'm really like too much into this. So I have a question, like I'm in future, like I really wanted to become pursue the PM roles, like product management roles. So does this course have like particular courses related to that, and like how will be the, as this it started 5 years back, so like not much is there on Google or somewhere like that, so that I can search a lot about it. So like what about the campus placement and all that, if anybody could answer that.
Okay, so before we go into the placement part or even the kind of courses, maybe both Priyanka and Harichikesh, because they are doing product management, it might be a good idea, both Priyanka and Harichikesh, if you could see that what part of the program that helped you to do. I think you already touched upon the user research part, but other than that, the kind of work that goes into product management, how does the course kind of address that, if you can answer that. then I'll come to the program and courses.
When you look at product management, okay, there is no definite playbook to define that this is what product management is. It is a set of different experiences that you bring on, okay, and then you, like a technologist can also be a product manager. Where this course comes in, this course fits in that you get a lot to learn. When I'll give you another, like all the subjects other than, if I leave user research aside, particularly other subjects that helped me out was like engineering of large management systems, where you understand what is the problem, what is the problem statement basically that you're looking into. And like that is one of the core aspects when you look into product management. You look for problems basically, not the solution part of it. Then there are other courses, like say, for example, looking into designing of like technological solutions, and also looking at the privacy aspect. So course gives you one of the, like it prepares you, the bunch of courses are as such that it prepares you to step into the industry, and it's up to you how you want to leverage it. And like, since you have done BCA, so I'm from the same boat as yours. So I had my already, if you are coming into the course, I'll recommend you definitely have your previous basics definitely brushed up, because you are going to build on top of that. My undergrad and most possibly my postgrad, it helped me to explore my career path where I am today. So it was not like that you are going to explicitly explore product management in this course, but it will help you out. Definitely it will help you out and like make you the standalone person to look into that, how things are defined, how you look into the bigger picture, how you look into the problem space. So that is where I'll say it helped me out. And currently it is still helping me out in the product management space. Yeah, over to you, Priyanka.
Yeah, so I think Harishikesh kind of put it in a way which is correct, that the courses will, I mean, it's not a guided step-by-step process towards product management, but definitely the courses all add up in a way where they help you get into the product management domain. I think we already spoke a lot about user study, user research, but there I have also learned a lot through courses like qualitative research and quantitative research, even to an extent with respect to data analytics. So these courses, you know, these courses always come really handy when you are doing product management, because if you look at it from a product manager's perspective, what do you do? What exactly does a product manager do? You need to do a basic market study. You need to do market research. You need to do user study. You need to define user journeys, which eventually you have to convert. You have to define your own metrics. You have to define your, you know, you have to define the KPIs, the primary metrics that you have to work on. And eventually you have to do wireframing, speak to various stakeholders, get the product out, and eventually evaluate the success of the product. So in the entire process, I mean, it's more detailed. I'm trying to put it up in a short way. In the entire process, there are various points where you like get in from the course. So user studies, where you learn a lot from the course. Then when you have to define the KPIs, a lot of quantitative and qualitative analysis does come handy at that point in time when you are defining the KPIs for your particular project. And then defining wireframes is also what I learned through one of the user research courses that I did at my point, when I was doing the course. And that did help. I mean, that did help and shape into the entire product management journey. And when you're done, when the product is actually out and you have to do a re-evaluation of the product, again, a lot of hypothesis defining, a lot of analysis of the product from a social intersection point of view does come very handy. So, I mean, it is not a very, you know, if I have to sum it up, it is not a very step-by-step process towards product management, but overall, in the time span of 1.5 to 2 years, it definitely helps a lot if you are looking forward to get into the product management domain.
Professor Amit also teaches a course on, you know, complex system and system thinking. And there, I think he also touches upon product management. Amit, if you could speak about your course a bit. And also maybe the placement question that Akanksha had.
I think the placement question is better answered by Priyanka and Arishikesh.
Yes, because, maybe.
Yeah, but let me assure you that you'll be doing good for yourself if you have taken the program seriously. And I think it's satisfying to see where what Arishikesh, Priyanka, Pradyumna are doing. You'll go through a lot of confusion and tension while you take the course. And I think to a certain extent that is built into the design of the program. It's not a program that gives you very clear cut answers. It's a program which allows you to ask questions. And that is something that my interpretation of the program is. It's not in that sense saying that, oh, if you do this, then this is going to become like you're going to solve the problem. And I think from my understanding of the product space, you need to have that kind of mindset. You need to be entrepreneurial. You need to take risks. You need to explore options. And if you have to do that in the realm of digital technology and the kind of markets we want digital technologies to get into, some of the understanding of social structures, relationships become very important. And we have quite a few courses that also allow you to understand that, apart from methods, apart from courses on HCI, which tell you how to do wireframing, how to do, say, look at users, etc. There's also this understanding of the domain, and the domain is the use context. And the use context, I think there was a question earlier on marginal population, underserved groups, etc. So we get into some of those in some of our courses. And all that with an understanding that it will allow you to understand the market better. It will allow you to understand what is it that people or groups of people value. How do we understand what they value? And if digital technologies were to be deployed, employed for them, what nature and form should those technologies take? So in that sense, the product space is something that we definitely want our students to get into. As Pradyumna was also saying, apart from the standard coursework-based courses, which are more structured, you also have these option of electives. And I do remember, some of the students opt for that, for these kinds of electives. If they want to get into, certain domains and certain kinds of functions that the standard courses don't offer. So if you're interested in products, if you're interested in, and let me also, to a certain extent, the way product is being developed today, we also want to question that through this program. We don't entirely, at least I don't entirely agree with the way products are designed in the industry. And through the kind of, orientation we want to provide, we want, people like Priyanka and Harishikesh at some stage to also shape the product industry so that it is more appreciative of the kind of use context, the kind of social groups the products are to be designed for.
The placement question, who wants to take it?
Okay, so I think I can answer to answer your placement question. So you need to know the companies or the kind of startups you actually want to get into, and that knowledge you will primarily get when you are into the course. So that is one thing which is like, again, a sense of flexibility that is there. But trust me, if you're getting into the product management domain, placement becomes like, it's a good, it's like people are, there's a lot of demand for product managers is at this point in time in the market. I mean, every second company is looking out for product managers, and they, because that kind of to a great extent defines the way their product is going to shape up. And if you are interviewing for such set of companies and you ask them the right set of questions, give them the right set of approach, then definitely entering into the industry is not that difficult. And once you enter into the industry, you will automatically come across so many opportunities that it kind of becomes very easy. And I think Harishikesh, he can add on. But for me personally, I mean, I never faced a difficulty saying that maybe I'm coming from digital society course, so this company might not take me up, or this company might not like this company might take me up, or if my knowledge is not sufficient to fill in for the requirements within the industry. That is not the case at all. It is very much apt with respect to what industry requires at the moment. Agreeing to what Professor Amit was saying, that definitely we bring in a different perspective towards how product management, like, you know, the way the products are being defined, the way the products are being built. And that is what perspective right now the industry is trying to look at and is trying to find, and which is what we pitch in, and that actually really helps, you know, in the placement part. That, does it help or like...
Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing this knowledge. It was really helpful. And ma'am, one more question I got, that what is the intake capacity for this course? What's the strength? I've seen it's,
maximum, if you can share. We can take maximum number of students we can take in a batch is 30.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Harishikesh, you wanted to talk about the placement as well?
Yes. Akanksha, I'll say that I, building on what Priyanka said, so I think you should not, once you are in this course, right, okay, there is a definite that you have that, okay, you want to go into product management. But I'll say keep your options open, okay, because you should look into, there is an angle to product management, what we are doing here, but there are some very other good roles within the organizations that you can explore. Okay, so the course also enables you to look into the policy angle of it. Okay, when right now we are working with different partners like PwC and EY. So there we look at that people don't have this depth of knowledge to look into the policy angle. Or if you're looking into different, there can be another role, say, for example, how to handle a program. So even those aspects can be explored, and eventually you can transition into a product management role. It all depends how you actually look into your, how you shape up your journey in this course. And I'm telling you, organizations are they are interested in what value you bring onto the table. So if you have that, there is, and like Priyanka said, that the demand is always there and it will be there, but it all depends on what you want to bring in. So that's my short bit of it.
Sure. Thank you so much. I will really look forward to that. I will, obviously they'll keep my options open, but there was one mindset in my, I've thought that I will go into such roles, so I asked. Otherwise, obviously, which will be better, which interests me or excites me, I'll go there.
Absolutely. And it might change right now if you're
yeah, it might change, obviously.
So all the best.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to add one thing from the institute's point of view. So we do have a placement office, which actually helps you with, reaching out to recruiters and all. But I think one thing I just wanted to clear out here, because I think Karthik was also in our previous Q&A, and there also we put this out very clearly, that you know, a lot of the times if you're coming from an engineering background and joining IITB, many of the students take the Digital Society program as a substitute of MDiv. And as a result of that, what they land up aspiring for, you know, jobs which are meant for MTech student, which essentially the very technical roles. And as a result of that, aspiring for those technical roles which are meant for MTech graduates, a lot of the time students face rejection, and this kind of make them demotivated, make them also questions that why can't I get the MTech roles. So I think this we have been, you know, now that we are also experienced in this, doing this for a while now, that we just wanted to put that out very clearly that this is not a substitute of an MTech course. So this course does not train you to do the roles that a typical MTech would do. And as Priyanka and Harishikesh already pointed out, it actually gives you more specific roles. And as long as you understand that what is the specific roles in different industries, so industry is also not homogeneous, right? You can, I mean, both Priyanka and Harishikesh works in very different types of organization. And even if you want to go to a policy think tank, you know, research within industry, all these, there are very different kinds of roles which are in demand, and those are the roles that we train you for. So I think recently I had a chat with Priyanka, and one of the things that she said, which really brought a smile to my face, was, you know, she said, you know, when we also had this thing when we joined that, oh, the MTechs are, you know, earning a lot more and all. But I, Priyanka, you can add in, I don't want to, you know, speak on your behalf, but she says that I have a lot more autonomy, and I am, you know, I'm happy with what I'm making. And I am in a better position than a regular MTech would have been. So, and this something that she has understood over the years, right? That you're not really competing for this large. So we have about 150, 180 people who graduate with an MTech degree every year. So the kind of roles that they go in, and the kind of role just, you know, we are looking for 10 people or 20 people, are going to be very different. So I think that is a very important point that you should keep in mind.
So my name is Sudhir. I have a bachelor's in information technology, and I've been working as an IT and marketing manager for more than 2 years now. So my role is actually more focused on, my role is more of a technical role and a little bit focused on the marketing aspects of it and all. But during my career, I understood, like, you know, whenever we are coming up with a new project idea or a new marketing idea or something like that, there was always a bit of a disconnect between what the user might be, what the user might want, and whatever it is that we are doing. And that kind of led me to on, like, so I wanted to do like a master's program, and I was looking for something that can help me, you know, against that sort of skills and like that sort of knowledge regarding like how can I connect with people more and design or something like that, more towards like what people are looking for and all. But predominantly, like, I'm also interested in staying in a technical role even after my graduation or something like that. So this course, like you said, it's not like an MTech course and all, but it does have a technical component to it. So what kind of, like, in the curriculum, like, you know, what are some of the technical things that we could be learning? Is there like a programming component to it? I noticed that there are some courses like application development, software development, and spatial information systems and so on. How much of the course has like a technical component? Is it intensive? What can we expect and so on?
Pradyumna, you want to take that up?
Hi, yeah, sure. I think, you know, when I was a student there, we actually, I don't think we had these technical roles. I don't recall, you know, having these courses, but I think my juniors did. And I think the way I understand from what my juniors told me is that You know, basically these are, you know, courses for you, for people, especially, you know, remember that a lot of students would come to this program from you know, various disciplines, maybe without an engineering or a computer science background. And it's, the way I understood it is, you know, these courses are really just to sort of get a basic sense of you know, the landscape, you know, from a sort of a programming standpoint, from understanding computer systems, you know. So I think to me it was an introductory course.
I would like to add to this, Sudhir. Just want to understand. Currently, are you in an execution role right now? Say, for example, when you're into bachelor's of IT, so you are like into the coding aspect of it as well as looking at the deliverable?
Yes, precisely, kind of like that. So I'm interested in the technical aspects of, I'm interested in a technical role, like a software developer or something, but I always lack that understanding of how to, let's say, design a product for a particular group of audience or something. How can I reach them better with that particular design or that particular idea or something like that?
So the course will actually help you to conceptualize at a bigger picture. Okay. Say, for example, right now you're just building a component. Okay. Maybe not knowing that, okay, what are you delivering it for? Okay. Now you have been, this is just an idea, I might be wrong here. You're just given that component right away, but someone might have conceptualized that component beforehand. So the course will actually help you to understand how you design that entire component. So it looks into the bigger picture of okay, this is my problem statement. Whom am I solving it for? What are the ways I should look into this? And then the execution part is something. And I think during my 2 years, we never had this like a demarcation that you cannot attend the courses. You can definitely audit the courses. You can have your primary objective that you always have, like I mentioned before, but you can definitely look into, this will help you out to be more like the orchestrator of a technology. Okay. Like you have the skills, you know how to do it. Okay. But now you will be also getting an information. What do you actually want to do?
Yeah.
So in that sense, it will help you out better. That's what my understanding is.
Let me also add a few things here. When you say in terms of say your continued interest in programming, you can definitely continue that. So there are the understanding is, because you have IT background, you would have gone through certain courses, the basic courses in C or Python and all that, and you would be aware of certain programming fundamentals, etc. We have a couple of courses, but they are more pegged at foundations, because we'll have a diverse cohort. We'll have students from non-engineering, non-computer science background also. And in that sense, the programming foundations in the fundamentals in the prep term and application programming, which is a 2-credit course in the first term, they'll help you gain some understanding, basic understanding, which those who have already had that kind of exposure, there is a more advanced level course that can be taken up instead of the more basic course. But having said that, you can continue your programming, say, interests. The difference would be, as Harishikesh was also pointing out, the courses that you take as part of the digital society will probably open up your thoughts to questions around why a product like this or why an approach like this is being followed, rather than following it because it has been told to you. So the ability to ask critical questions of the product and of the process is something that will be an add-on to what you do in your programming, which you can gain from the courses that are offered as part of digital society. So while you may not have advanced programming algorithm type of courses. You can take a course of the four electives. You can pick up one elective which is offered to other students of the computer science and electronics programs. But as part of Digital Society Core, we don't have advanced level programming courses. But the way you approach programming, the way you look at application development is hopefully expected to change. And if you go through some of these courses, and we feel that that change can be useful for you in terms of, say, your longer term career growth.
Thank you, sir. So I just want to point out a specific course that I saw, geographic information systems, for example. So from what you said, so geographic information systems can have like a it's a huge area that can be discussed, and also there's a lot of technical component to it, like analyzing the systems itself and analyzing the data and all. So from what you said, the geographic information systems could be explained in more of like, you know, what can be done, you know, what is it about, and what are the opportunities in that, rather than actually, you know, doing some analysis or doing some kind of like an application in that or something like that. Am I right?
Yes, it will be more application oriented. It will be more. So for example, if you're using a geographical, say a GIS application, and you're using it to provide better navigation facilities to Uber drivers,
yeah.
Right? So if you were to do something like that, what kind of interface would make sense, or what kind of GIS layers would make sense for an application and a user segment like that is what you may be able to do rather than getting inside the internals and looking at what would be a good algorithm which will give me the shortest route, right?
That's true, yeah. Thank you, sir.
Are there any questions, any other questions that you need? Anybody else?
I just wanted to ask, like, do we have flexibility on choosing the like number of courses to kind of finish the course credit requirement part early on, or how does it go about? Because I'm particularly asking this in context with something that I found on the website. It was written somewhere that we also have an option of like 6 month semester abroad kind of a thing, wherein we can pursue some research internships also. So, and that is towards the end part of the program. So how does that work out?
So yes, the first 2 year, first two semesters, we have only core courses. The second semester, along with your core courses, you can take one elective. Third semester is completely electives, and within these electives, you can also take project electives or reading electives, as I think Pradyumna mentioned earlier. So project electives are mostly when you have a specific project, like a research problem or a project that some of the faculties are already working on, and work on that over the over a semester. And some students also continue to do that, convert that into their thesis, or some use this kind of project electives to understand, build their portfolio to do internship in the industry. So there are, so that is the third semester. And so that's where you have the flexibility of what kind of courses that you want to choose from the electives, or if you want to have an independent project. So currently, for example, and this is where the project electives actually give you a lot more flexibility. So I think one of our current student, he is working on a project elective which is looking at fake news detection through a professor here who works on cybersecurity. So these are some of the examples. I think Pradyumna worked with Janaki. I'll let Pradyumna speak about it. Pradyumna, I think, worked on two projects, one with Janaki, one with Amit. One was on work on in our EGA platform, and the other he worked with Amit, which was on digitization in schools in Karnataka. So these are some of the ways in which you can also get yourself involved. We also encourage, this is not part of your program requirement, but the students do summer internships with with faculty member and their projects, or sometimes they even do it outside. Many a times they also, Prashant was another alumni who was supposed to join us again, could not join because of the pandemic. He used to work with this Everwell Foundation, Research Foundation, which looks at, he was also into product management role. And I think he is now switching job. He's going to join Wadhwani Institute in Bombay in a research group called AI for Social Good. So he did a, you know, summer internship project with the IGOR Foundation for 2 months, which was unpaid, but which really helped him to build his, this looking at large public systems or public governance systems and understand how these systems should be designed or how these systems actually work. So that, does that answer your question, Karthik?
Yeah, sure.
And I think earlier there was one question about HCI. So right now we offer two HCI courses. One is a basic course, which is a core course that everybody has to take. And as an elective, we also have an advanced HCI course. So that if somebody wants to get into product design, that's something that they can take up.
And are there any like international university collaborations for research?
Yes, Pradyumna definitely works on one. Pradyumna, you want to talk about? He works with the Oxford Internet Institute. So he works for Oxford Internet Institute. He works with faculty at IIIT.
Yeah, so Karthik, I did an internship in the first two quarters of 2019. So I work with on the Fair Work project, and so this project is basically, it's based out of the University of Oxford, and so the idea is to have partners in multiple countries, to study a growing phenomenon of sort of working for apps. So I think the classic example is like an Uber. So. So this notion of signing up to an app and then the app giving you instructions and then you working for it, and that as a phenomenon has sort of taken the world by storm in the past 10 years. And what Fair Work as a project does is it studies basically, given that it's sort of growing at such a scale, the project wants to kind of understand what exactly the working conditions within these relationships look like. And, so it's basically an intervention. So we're trying to see how we can bring about meaningful change to the working conditions and lives of these workers who are working on these apps. And so one of the things that we do is we score leading platforms on the basis of how fair they treat their workers. And so I as part of my internship I think 5 months, I helped worked with the team there and worked with Dr. Janaki and Balaji here so it was basically a collaborative effort. And I think there are a couple of other projects also, with collaborations that sort of span countries. Yeah.
Thank you so much. So the professors here, could you please elaborate on the research projects that you're involved in right now?
Yes. So I currently work on, two projects on Aadhaar. I think one of them is coming to an end very soon, and the other one will continue. So, the one that would continue comes under, if any of you are aware, so IIITP hosts this MOSIF Foundation, which is modular and open ID platforms, so this foundation is supporting my work on Aadhaar. So here we are looking at this. I am working in collaboration with Professor Amit Prakash. So we are looking at how digital identity are implemented in India in different domains. So One is welfare. We are recently conducting a study with migrant laborers and their use of digital identity and how it helped in mobility in India, especially in the context of what happened last year in the wake of the lockdown and the kind of the journey that the migrant laborer had to take. So that is one work that I do. I also do a participatory design work in Indian Sundarbans, which is in collaboration with, which is funded by the Sheffield Hallam University in UK. And that, the funding is over. We are still, because of the pandemic, of course, the qualitative part, the research part is still kind of pending. We have been working on this. Yeah, so that is another project. So we're there, we are trying to build weather information system, mostly a community-led weather information system that can help the farmers, small-holding farmers in Sundarbans to face climate change. You might be aware that that area really is affected by climate change and also very frequent, cyclone. As a result of climate change that they have been facing. So in that struggle, how a weather information system can bring in more predictability. But our perspective is not to make a very expert driven, usually, this is what I think Amit was talking about, to question the way things have been designed, that things have been implemented. So what we are trying to do is to build in a weather information system, which is led by the community, which is curated and maintained by the community. So that, for example, in last 1 year, we have not been able to travel, right, to the field. But the project has sustained and they have been able to sustain it with whatever resources they had. And it was possible because we incorporated them in the design process. They were, they developed it together with those with a little bit of expertise that we brought in from outside. So there is another project that I've been working on. Other than that, I work with Janaki here on a project on work and automation. So we are looking at current phase of AI-based automation and how that going to affect skill in the industry, how that is going to affect work relations in the industry. So currently we are doing digital ethnographic study of data labeling work, which is usually done in Bangalore. And data labeling work for e-commerce platforms. So who are these people who do this data labeling? What kind of skill they require? What kind of automation or what kind of tools that they use? Many of you might be aware that data labeling is also a way of future automation. By labeling data, you are preparing the training data set for machine learning algorithms to work. So in this sense, this kind of work also has future implications for further automation. So this is the fourth project or the last one, so that it doesn't feel like I'm working on everything else under the sun. So the last one also that I work on is on mostly politics of data and algorithms. So we look at large scale data in public sectors like microfinance or transportation, and trying to analyze those data to see the kind of data that is available, how that help us make, or how policy has been made around those data sets, what kind of biases that exist in this data set. And when policies are made around based on those data set, how those policies are also can have a biased impact. So I'll stop here. I'll let maybe Janaki and Amit to speak about their project.
So I'm working with Bidisha on a couple of these projects, so I won't go into too much detail, and I think Pradyumna also spoke about Fair Work, so I won't speak on those. One other project that I'm currently working on, which I'm very excited about, is something that we are doing based on research that was carried out of IIT Delhi in parts of UP, where they were trying to understand the relationship between changes in agricultural patterns and changes in people's diets, dietary practices, and nutritional well-being, right? That was research that they're already carrying out. What we wanted to do was to build a digital repository where we could actually have oral histories and video narratives of these histories of how agriculture changed in that area, how people's dietary practices used to be and how they have changed. And the thinking behind this project was really that, you know, one of the things that I think digital technologies was hailed for right from the start was its democratizing potential. And of course, as you learn repeatedly through the course, we'll argue that that potential is not so much in the technology as it is in how you choose to leverage it. And we felt that one of the opportunities that such technologies really offer, given a sort of broader access to them than previous more expensive technologies, is that people can tell their own stories. And we felt like a lot of research on agriculture, especially in India and around the Green Revolution, tends to sort of tell one story. It sounds as though the Green Revolution panned out the same way throughout the country. It had the same implications for everybody. But of course, we have been finding out over the last 3-4 decades almost that that's not true. But then what did happen on the ground? And how did people's lives change, whether it was in terms of how they cultivate or in terms of how they eat? How, what has changed, right? So we are conducting oral histories. Of course, COVID intervened like with everything else. But we are very hopeful that we'll still be able to finish that by the end of this year to put together a digital portal, which is basically a digital documentation portal where we can juxtapose academic research and people's own histories of how they live their lives and conduct their work and their dietary patterns. So that's one project that I'm really excited about. But I'm also doing some of this other work with Pradyumna and Vidisha. So I'll just say that.
Well, I've been working in the space of e-governance and looking at ICTs and how they have been used by various government departments. Within that, most of my work in recent years has been at the service delivery unit level. So I work in the area of public health and nutrition, and my predominant field sites have been primary health centers, Anganwari centers, health sub centers in that sector. Education, looking how schools, primarily government schools, how do they interact with technology? Service deliveries, other kinds of service deliveries, which includes public distribution system, which includes land records, computerization, which includes property registration, computerization, etc. So that's one thematic area. The other one that I've been focusing a lot more over the last 2-3 years is this area of accessibility. And I've been working with an organization that was set up with our by our former students. In fact, one of them is from Priyanka's batch in 2017, and Microsoft Research, and a few other organizations, to see how education can be made more accessible for persons with visual impairment and other disabilities using digital technologies. So that's another area that I've been dabbling in over the last 2-3 years.
So one last question I want to ask is regarding the entrance test. So I looked at the sample paper on the website, and the quantity of the questions and everything seems to be smaller. So do we, can we expect like the same sort of paper, or like what else can you tell us about like entrance test, something to prepare for?
Okay, so the entrance test, as you can see on our website, there are 3 components this time for the proctored online exam. That would be the numerical, the analytical, and the design awareness. Along with it, what we are introducing, usually we have 6 components in the exam and then just an interview. But along with it, what we're introducing this year, that when you come for the interview, there will also be a writing test. And in that writing test, what we are going to evaluate you, your IT awareness, your social awareness, and also your communication, verbal communication while in the interview, but also the written communication. So this is another additional component that we have added this year. The exam, I think, yeah, the questions that you have, those are going to be the similar kind of questions that we are going to ask. And yeah, I don't think it's a very difficult. Let me ask my alumni to answer that question. Was the test very difficult? Or what was the level of the exam, the entrance exam?
I don't remember it, to be honest.
Yeah, so they cracked it. So, of course, I don't think it was that difficult. Does it answer your question, Sudhir?
Sure, yeah. So, that's the thing. I looked at like it and I understood that the subjects and modules that might be covered, but I couldn't get that, you know, difficulty never or level or like, you know, it wouldn't be on the like the same basis as like a CAT exam or something like that. That was the part I was a bit confused about, but I think based on what you said, it would be fairly simple, similar sort of questions and all. Thank you for that. Yeah.
Okay. Just in one line, you don't have to stress about it.
Okay, thank you for that.
Yeah, there are too many things to stress about right now. Don't stress about this exam. Okay, so if there are no other questions, then thank you, Priyanka, thank you, Pradyumna, and thank you, Harishikesh, for making this on a Saturday afternoon and waiting so patiently and answering all the questions so nicely. And also thank you that you had nice things to say about the program. And thank you everyone who joined us. Thank you, Janaki. Thank you, Amit. Thank you, Swati, for making this happen. Thank you, everyone.